My name is Prita. I'm a faculty in the Department of Metallurgical Engineering and Material Science. And the topic that I'm going to talk about, it's an odd topic to have to cover, but it's also an extremely important topic to have to cover. And I think all of you who have dealt with students, who have dealt with administrative responsibilities, would realize that this is a topic on which we actually need more and not less conversation. But before I get started, a lot of the material that I'll show you in this slide is taken from a talk or a similar lecture that Professor Sahanamurthy gave in this IST workshop, which was held at IIT Bombay. See, basically, so when I write this definition, and I've taken this definition from the dictionary essentially. And if you look at this definition, this is really broad. You know, this can potentially cover just about anything, right? It says ethics. What are ethics? So ethics deal with values relating to human conduct with respect to the rightness and wrongness of certain actions. These are really loaded words, right? What is right and what is wrong? And then to the goodness and badness of the motives. This is even worse, right? I mean, who decides what's good, who decides what's bad, and who knows the motives underlying somebody's actions? Too big to cover. No, not possible, and way beyond the scope of anything that we would do in this class. What we are going to do is, we are going to limit ourselves to ethics in academics. And we will initially, for I think the first 20 minutes or so, talk about ethics in the classroom in interactions with students, ethics in teaching basically, and then we will talk about ethics in research. And that's going to be our domain. That's it, you know, no global right and wrong and good and bad and so on. I'm not competent enough to make those judgments. So, when I teach this course to students, I like asking them this question somewhere towards the beginning of the lecture. And I ask them that, you know, the student and their roommate are taking the same course and the roommate spent the weekend partying and didn't do the assignment. And the assignment has to be submitted on Monday morning. So Monday morning, everybody is getting ready to run to the department and the student asks the roommate, well, you've done the assignment, right? And then you ask the students, okay, what will you do? Now there are two ways of answering this question. One is, what do they actually do? What do they commonly do? And they know what they commonly do and we also know what they commonly do, right? But a different way to ask this question is that this is a question given to you in an exam. And there are 2 marks for a right answer and there is minus half a mark for a wrong answer. Now what is the answer? And they all know what the right answer is, right? Just like we know what the right answer is. So we know that the right answer is this, right? That you don't show the assignment, but you agree to spend time with the roommate and explain the topic to them so that they can figure things out on their own. Because we all know that that is the purpose of doing an assignment. And they also know that this is what they should do. In an ideal world, all our students would be doing this, right? Then you tell them, okay, fine, you know, no marks. What do you actually do? And we also know that what they actually do is, actually this part is also, you know, I think wishful thinking on my part. What mostly happens is, this is a good friend. This is just an assignment, layar. You know, because we know that tomorrow situations might be reversed. You know, I might be out partying and he would have done the assignment and, you know, live and let live, right? Let's all be nice to each other. That's what we do, right? We know that. We also know that this is not what we should be doing. We also know that our attitude towards this live and let live attitude is what slowly, I think, degrades an inner moral compass that we have, which tells us right from wrong. You know, wo ye chalta hai aur fir wo chalta hai and then kuch aur chalta hai and then, you know, everything becomes chalta hai. And we all pay the price. You know, it's not like he suffers and nothing happens to me or I suffer and nothing happens to you. So why do they do it? You know, then I ask them. I mean, my class usually on this topic is a freewheeling discussion. I said, okay, so you know what you should do, you know what you do. Why is there a disconnect between what you should do and what you're actually doing? And I think some of the reasons are, the reason that I'm given most commonly is everyone does it. Okay? And then if you ask, who is everyone? Everyone is you and me and her and him, right? That's what everyone is. So I do it, but I say I do it because he does it, right? So, but that is what they say, ma'am, everybody does it. Seniors do it, juniors do it, why shouldn't we do it? Everyone does it. I think the other reason from the perspective of now being a teacher and there being a student is that, I mean, at least as far as assignments are concerned, most of the times they don't get caught because we don't spend that much time, you know, figuring out who's copied whose assignment. There are so many things to do, there are too many students, blah, blah, blah. So they also know that the risk of being caught is very low. And even if they are caught, the punishment is very mild, right? If you find a copied assignment, what is the worst that you've ever done? Sorry?
Don't give marks,
right? But what is the weightage of one assignment in their final total, right? Out of 100 marks, one assignment is maybe 2 marks, right? So 0 out of 2. That's the worst, right? So mild punishment. The other reason that students often give, and I think I completely understand what they are saying, is peer pressure. You know, if you don't show an assignment, you become the bad guy. Pata nahi apne aap ko samajhti kya hai. That's the approach, right? Why won't you? That's the dumb thing. That's what friends do. Friends let friends copy. So if you, there is too much peer pressure. And I completely understand what they are saying. Some of them really do feel bothered by this. But they say that, you know, then they become the bad person if they don't show it. So, you know, it's a difficult choice for them. So, I mean, this is my suggestion to you, to me. I mean, you know, I'm thinking of all of us as teachers, that what do we do? Now, one approach could be that the assignments that we give, these should reward effort instead of just the correct answer. You know, if we can somehow convince them that when I evaluate your assignment, I am only looking at the amount of effort that you've put in. I don't care whether, you know, you get 15.23 or you get 17.28. As long as you can show me that you've thought through the problem, that's what I want. Okay? Then maybe, you know, they'll think otherwise. It's not simply about filling in the blanks and so on, right? And then, but if you want to do this, then you have to design problems that somehow bring out the thought process of the person. And if we can design problems like that, then they will also realize that copying is not very easy, because identical problems, no two individuals will have the same, exact same thought procedure to go through those problems, right? And what also helps students is that if there is a clearly stated policy against copying, and very important, it is implemented. There is a policy against copying. Of course, there's a policy against copying. It's the implementation where we sometimes, you know, we melt. 4 people come cry in our office, and then what do they do? So this may have an effect. Okay. Now, so this is from a student's perspective, what do we expect when we're in a classroom? What do we expect? What do students expect? How do we deal with them? But a lot of what we do and a lot of how we interface with the world outside is to do with the research that we do. The research that we do, the projects that our students do, all of that, right? And I think a lot of the talks and the discussions that you've had here have been about, you know, writing and presenting and, you know, presenting ideas and putting across ideas, which are mostly centered around research. Okay. So now what when we start doing research, when we go to this other role, not as a teacher but as a researcher. Now these are points that are, I think, pretty good generic guidelines. No. Don't do research that puts people at risk. Don't do research that violates informed consent. Okay? Don't do biased research, and don't copy things from others. Again, you know, nothing very great that I can tell you. This is something that we all know. But there are, I would like to hear your inputs, at least for a short period of time, on each of these topics. That if I said, okay, can you give me one example of research that put people's lives at risk? Can you think of one example each? And we have, I think, what do we have? Do we have one, Einstein. Two? Sorry?
Einstein.
Einstein. Well, yes. So Einstein did put people's lives, the work that he did put people's lives at risk. And examples like this make this very difficult, right? Like, would we want to go back in history and wish that there was no Einstein? Okay.
One aspect of Einstein that has put the people into this.
Okay, right. So we wish that he just hadn't done that. Everything else is okay.
But if you have taken patent over it.
Okay.
Electric free for the...
And...
To use it.
Okay.
And was there? That was the problem.
That was the problem. Okay.
Clinical trials.
Clinical trials. Right. Now you're also touching upon the second topic here. Right. So would you like to elaborate on it just a little bit? What sort of clinical trials should not be done?
New molecule which is untested on human beings,
mm-hmm.
or probably first tested on animals and then put in, but they are not correctly informed.
Right.
Certain research
right.
Of such nature, probably abroad we have that concept of taking a approval, then
right.
covering them through insurance and then getting their consent before it's put for application.
Right.
Probably in India there's a gross violation on that.
Right. In India there have been reports of gross violations of this, and this sort of, thanks for that point, because this ties these two things together, right? What is informed consent? That a person should be clearly informed that this is a trial, the outcomes are not 100% known, and these are the potential risks, right? Only then if the person says yes, should they be made part of that trial, else not, right? We don't do that very often, and by not doing that, we put their lives at risk without their agreement, okay? Now, biased research. What do we mean by biased research? I think I have another example of this a little later. Can you think of an example of biased research, any area?
Something where you put one segment against another.
Something where you put one segment against other, right?
Getting the data.
Right.
And then trying to showcase that what you are trying to say is the final truth.
Right.
Especially the one that has been put across recently, the demographic surveys.
Mm-hmm.
Probably when government puts across the census data or the number of accidents, and then trying to indicate, doesn't hold water. We always look it with a suspect, whether it's done with an intention.
See, for example, suppose I am a consultant for a company that makes paints, right? And if study after study that comes out of my lab shows that the paints from that group are better than everything else in the market for all possible applications. Now, that would make people sort of step back and think a little bit about whether this is 100% unbiased information. It may so happen that that is really the best paint company and their products really are the best product, okay? But to do that, I'll come back to you in just one second, okay? To do that, I need to be able to prove the rigor of the experiments that have been done, the wide variety of samples that have been tested, and then show that yes, indeed, you know, this happens to be the best product in all of these categories. Okay, otherwise, you know, things may become suspect. Yes, you wanted to say something.
Yes, just one example came into my mind, like it's for the first one actually.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess around 1997,
mm-hmm.
the clone experiment on the sheep called Dolly, it was happened in Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, people were trying to do that kind of research project on human beings also. But because of the resistance from scientific communities from different part of this globe, so till now, this officially at least this research has been stopped from that
okay.
time. So that is one example where the ethics of that scientific communities has acted,
right?
Because they felt that it will
lead to Frankenstein's.
That.
Okay. So. Yeah, but again, see, these are all very debatable topics, right? Is it good? Is it not good? I mean, a person who's on an endless waiting list for a heart transplant will probably say it's a good thing. You know, if you can either clone people or if you can, you know, carry that research to grow an artificial heart, why not? So these are, again, the only point that I'm trying to make is that in some cases, the rights and wrongs are very clear. But not so in all the cases. I mean, Einstein was not a bad person. Einstein was a brilliant scientist. None of us wishes that Einstein had never been born. But yes, there may have been an aspect of his research for which there were fallouts, which maybe even he didn't anticipate. Okay. And then this one is actually fairly clear that we shouldn't copy research ideas. And this is also unfortunately more common that we would than we what we would like to believe, right? I see you laughing there. That no, there is a discussion and there is a freewheeling exchange of ideas and no, I hear something that is actually your idea and I already have the setup in my lab, go do it, publish it and you don't even know about it unless it's in print. Okay, that's not okay. So these are the things. Now, so let's now take this some example by example. Okay. Let's take the first example that you've been asked to characterize samples from a site where the ground may have been contaminated by some dangerous chemicals. Okay. Recently there was this big blast in China. I mean, we don't know what they were storing, how they were storing, whatever, whatever. The project is of national importance and the grant is very generous. Okay. But your lab currently doesn't have the required safety tools so that the researchers in the lab can test these samples without posing a risk to their own life and safety. But the funding agency needs preliminary results within 6 months. You are the expert, you are the first person they've come to. They say money is not an issue, do whatever you want, buy whatever you want. But we need to table a report, you know, in the parliament before some expert committee within 6 months. Can you do this? And you know, here is a big sack full of money for you for doing this. What do you do? So I have put forth only two options, maybe there are more options, that you take the project, tell the staff who's actually doing the experiments to be careful. You say, oh, you know, dhyan se karna bhai, sambhal ke karna. Without disclosing all the potential risks, you know, you don't tell the person that, look, this soil sample may have a potential carcinogen in it, okay, or some such similar thing. Or the other option is explain to the funding agency the importance of putting proper safety measures in place before you can start testing and refuse to start the project before that, knowing full well that you, while you are the foremost expert in the country, you're not the only person who can do tests like this. And because the funding agency has made it very clear that time is of the essence, if you say no, there is a high likelihood that they'll just go to somebody else. No, they may not wait. Now, again, the choices are never easy, right? Which is why these are moral dilemmas or these are ethical dilemmas. I mean, there is a huge price to pay for doing what you may still firmly believe is the right thing to do. Okay? But again, this is sort of like, you know, we are humans just like our students. We also know what we should do and we also know that what there is a high likelihood that we may end up doing. Okay? And it's just a matter of choice. Let me take a different example that you are having a discussion with a company, a private company, that's interested in having you as a consultant to evaluate a new product that they're developing. Okay? However, during discussions, they drop hints about how your strong support of their product would make them the market leaders and lead to a long research partnership with your group. You know, so this is a huge company and they do a lot of work in an area which overlaps with your area of research, and this is the proposition. Now, once again, I would like to hear your opinion on, you know, how would you go about handling this? Are there any problems? If there are problems, how should we deal with those? What do we do?
The blueprint of the whole research has to be submitted before we take
a... Blueprint of the whole research has to... Okay, can you elaborate
proposal,
on that?
The proposal. Okay. Which our company is trying to consult you. They are mm-hmm. supposed to submit the blueprint of whatever they are having in their mind in written form. Okay. In printed form so that we can go ahead. If it is according to us... Mm-hmm. I mean, ethics and as well as according to our company rules and regulations, principles, we can mm-hmm. go ahead. If it is okay. not accordingly, we can very well reject it.
But see, here there is a slight this thing that what is being proposed, you know, the kind of experiments or the kind of modeling, there isn't a problem with that. I mean, you know, that is perfectly above board. It's only things that are not written, only things that are said and that are hinted at and then, you know, you understand is what may be a problem.
The big
you
problem
know? So,
is
so
a strong
is not,
support.
This is never written down. Okay,
yes.
This is just, you know, are Professor Pant, aapko bhi pata hai ki, you know, we are the market leaders and this is a new product. And if this does really well, our market share will become, you know, more than anybody else. We'll be the international biggest this thing. Now, you know, and if you work with us, we can all do very well. Yes. These are all spoken. These things are never written down. So, yeah, sorry, you were saying something.
So, the consultant gets a hint that he may be pressurized if he doesn't give a good report about the project.
Mm-hmm.
The company may, you know, put different kinds of pressures. He may be under a pressure to give a good report. Because they've already dropped a hint that a strong support, his recommendation would
right.
be very useful.
Right.
So, that would, you know, put him into a dilemma later on.
Right. So, what is the option? Is the option, I mean, is the only option to not take this project? Are there other sort of, is there a middle path? Is it just, no, what should we do? What should I do? What would you do?
Once you have the transparency of what exactly has to be done.
Okay.
Both the parties have to know, like we sign a document of MOU and things like that,
mm-hmm.
where everything is written.
Hmm.
So, when we are trying to have a consultancy, it is a joint venture.
Right.
So, you should know what is your role and your input.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the other person should be clear enough to say, because generally they hide the things which are not to be spoken. Like
okay.
in the advertisements, they mm-hmm. put slightly the risk thing very tiny where
mm-hmm.
most of us omit.
Okay.
So, it has to be very open.
It has to be very open. Okay. Otherwise, it's not a good idea to get into an MOU with a company like this.
That would vary.
Okay.
Case to case.
Okay.
Not for all.
Okay.
It cannot be an universal.
Right. Yeah, none of these are universal, you know, which is why I said I don't have prescriptions, you know. I'm going to come to you with potential problems, potential scenarios, and there isn't a right or a wrong or a universal right or a wrong. So when we grapple with situations like this, you know, what are the challenges that we are facing? Well, the questions that we are trying to answer as we make these decisions is, how will this affect my career, my papers, my promotion, right? I keep saying no to lucrative projects because, no, cigarette company ka project nahi karenge, alcohol company ka project nahi karenge, paint company ka nahi karenge because they have said, you know, we want your strong support. So, I'm not getting any funding. If I don't get funding, you know, how do I buy instruments? How do I buy consumables? If I don't have those, where does my research go? Right? After all, doing research, especially if you're an experimentalist, is not cheap. And then the other question that comes to us, similar to what our students think, that, you know, if I don't do it, somebody will do it. Right? It's not like just because I say no, this kind of work is not going to get done. Then, you know, what great achievement is my saying no having here, you know, again, I'm not Einstein, that if I don't disclose the secret of the atomic bomb, nobody will be able to make the atomic bomb in the world. And sometimes we sort of manage to convince ourselves that, well, you know what, right now, let me just agree to what they are saying. Let me take the project. And I am this person of very strong integrity. I'll be able to withstand whatever pressures come my way. And I will really be able to report the results accurately. Come what may. Maybe it works sometimes, you know. Depends on you and depends on the results and depends on the person on the other side of the table. Maybe you can pull it off. In which case, it'll be great if you can pull it off. But, you know, as the lady here was pointing out, that if they've already made it clear that your strong support is what they are expecting, then, you know, you are still waiting to do the experiment. They already have a plot in mind, what the data is going to look like, okay? And if the data that comes out of your lab is very different from the data that's already in their head, you'll have a challenge on your hands. No, so if this is the route that we decide to take, then we should be very aware of, you know, how tough this road is going to be. Then start walking that road. Again, it's an individual choice. You know, there are. So, I have written this. You know, I know that this isn't easy, and I know that this isn't always possible. That being successful and achieving excellence in the work that you do does not have to be based on compromises, should not be based on compromises, right? That's when we all sleep well at night. And I mean, at some level, at least this should be the goal, that, you know, can we do this? From this point onwards, the only kind of ethical dilemma that I'm going to talk about is, so we're further narrowing the field, is in the area of reporting research, and where the biggest problem, or the only problem that we'll talk about, is plagiarism. Okay, now I assume you all know what plagiarism is, right? It's copying somebody else's work, be it something that they have written, some data that they have produced, a figure that they have made, an article that they have published on the web, whatever. Taking from somebody else and presenting it as your own. That's plagiarism in very, very simple terms. Now, I've taken this, sorry?
Scholarly theft.
Scholarly theft, yes. White collar crime. So, right? It's a crime committed by people who sit in front of computers, often in air-conditioned offices and labs. So this is a figure that was published recently in Science magazine, and what this is the outcome of an analysis that a group has done. So there is a database called Archive, ARXIV, and the X is written as capital, okay? It's probably one of the largest repositories of scientific papers, right? And so what they did was that when somebody uploads a paper to Archive, you have to declare the country which you are a resident of. So they had geographic information about the authors of various articles. And then they went and they took those articles and they looked for copied content in those articles. Okay? And based on what they found, they created this map. Now, this is a map of the world, of course, where this is the percentage of authors flagged to have had copied content. Okay? So, this light shade of red is 20% and this almost black thing is 5%. And lo and behold, you have a world map of copy. Okay? Not a very flattering thing to have to look at, but there it is. So we are here, right? I mean, not too bad, not the best, but not the worst either. So, and there are numbers here, you can check the exact percentages. So this says 471 of 4283 authors flagged. They do say that they put in some kind of a control. For example, I think one of the countries, there were only 3 papers submitted and 2 had copied content. So they didn't put it at 75%, you know, they just ignored data from that country. So they did things like that. So they had some threshold that the input or the article submitted from that country should have been at least so much for them to calculate percentages. So this is the map that you get. Now, you know, when we say copying is a problem, when discussions like this happen, this copying problem is no longer just my problem or your problem or, you know, somebody else's problem. It also becomes a problem of perception. You know, we all get labeled by one label, right? Because the one common identity that we have in this map is that we all happen to be living in this country, right? And now it doesn't matter that, oh, I have never copied anything in my papers and, you know, but, you know, that Professor X, पता नहीं क्या चलता है उनकी लैब में कुछ भी पब्लिश कर देते डजंट हेल्प राइट बिकॉज यू ऑल गेट लेबल्ड बाय अ कॉमन लेबल नो पेपर्स फ्रॉम चाइना आर लाइक दिस पेपर्स फ्रॉम इंडिया हैव यू नो 15% कॉपीड कंटेंट सो इट बिकम्स अ शेयर्ड प्रॉब्लम And which is why it's important to have these conversations. This is not to say that you are doing wrong and I'm doing right. This is to say that, look, we are part of a community. We are part of a community of academics, researchers, teachers, authors. And sometimes there are problems which we have to tackle as a community because they affect us all. Okay, that's the purpose of showing you this map. Now, I would like you to identify the correct answer in this, you know. So what is plagiarism, right? What does plagiarism do? Well, 10% is okay. It's too little, you know. I mean, 10 words in 100, big deal. Is and the hi ho jate honge, kya pata, who knows, right? Or, well, okay, you know, I read this and I can change active voice to passive voice. I know how to do that. I was taught in class 8th and I still remember. So, I can do this and then we are done, right? This is not copy. Of course, I have changed active voice to passive voice. Now we are okay. So, what do you think?
I ask the same thing.
Right.
If you are going to allow us for the plagiarism, what is the percentage?
Right.
Then, yeah, we can allow for 10 to 15%. I was laughing at him.
Okay. No, so somebody said that, you know, ideally, these are both wrong. And what IEEE guidelines at least say, I mean, you know, again, maybe there is a difference between what they put on their website and what they say in person. So what they say is that any amount of uncredited copying is considered plagiarism. And they also clarify that when they are looking at these percentages, what will influence their decision if a complaint comes to them is probably the percentage, you know. So maybe 10% is just, well, withdraw this paper, and maybe 50% is never ever submit a paper to IEEE journal again. So there is a gradation in punishments, not in deciding whether something is plagiarized or not. Okay. And then I found this quotation, which I just absolutely loved. So it says, so Samuel Johnson had some manuscript and writes, "Your work is both good and original. Unfortunately, the parts that are good are not original, and the parts that are original are not good." So this is a really, really damning review to receive. Okay, but it was just, you know, this I loved it, and I thought that I have to share it with you when we are having this discussion on plagiarism. So this is what happens, you know. Plagiarism can really damage your reputation and your self-esteem if you get comments like this. So this is what I had already said, that according to IEEE, so this is what they write, you know, there's a disconnect between what they say and they write, that the amount doesn't matter, but it may play a role in deciding what the consequences of plagiarism are. Okay. No, but this is not, you said that 10 to 15% is okay.
It might be a lot.
I see. Okay. So maybe 10 to 15%, you know, just a rap on the knuckles and they'll let you go, and 50% you get sent to the principal's office or something. So now, sometimes, you know, my students ask me this because they're just getting started in some area and they're reading all these papers and they're convinced that these papers have been written by great and wonderful people, and the way those great and wonderful people have written the papers, nobody can do any better, right? I mean, this is the best way of explaining this topic. Okay? So strength, you know, well, Young wrote a paper some several years back describing what the elastic strength or the stiffness of a material is like, and I mean, you know, those words, how can I improve on that? So what do I have to do? Well, let me just copy the exact text from Young's book and I'll put a citation. I'm not cheating. The citation is right there. So I have taken this text word by word from the article that accompanied that world map that I showed you. Okay, I've just copied and pasted it here. And of course, I'm telling you upfront that this is taken from this source. Is this okay? Yes?
It is post-mortem.
Okay, what does that mean?
See, you have yield all these things. But after you have post-mortem in that, you have put in that citation and to really work.
Well, I could put the citation right at the top, you know, the title could be the citation, taken from blah, 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 and then put the text. Will that be okay?
Yeah, it will be okay then.
Okay.
Where is the creativity?
I see. Okay. So your problem is that there is nothing coming from me. Okay?
I say.
I mean, there is no.
See, what is the contribution of us?
Right. Exactly. Exactly. Right. So everything is just taken from somewhere else. What did you write?
What is our contribution? That's important.
Okay.
In the present form, it is not okay. I agree with his point that what is the author's contribution needs to be explained there, and what is coming out.
And under double quotes.
Whatever we are writing.
That's the important thing. Yeah. That if you ever are in a situation where you feel that no, you know, for impact, for accuracy, for displaying the mood of the author when he was writing this poem, I have to quote a small piece or I have to quote a big piece, then the only correct way of doing it is please put quotation marks along with the citation. So there is a difference between taking material from a source. Every time we do literature review, that's what we are doing. We're reading others' papers and then we are presenting them. Okay. That is still different from presenting it in their words. So any word by word reproduction must be accompanied by quotation marks to tell the reader that here, not just the idea, but even the words are taken from that source. Okay. So quotations are important. So just giving credit is not enough. Okay. This may be okay. So this is the original. Electronic simulations may increase student access to a lab experience since they're not constrained to a specific time and place. And this is what has been written. Since a student can use simulation anytime and anywhere, the simulation can improve the student's access to experimentation. Okay? This now falls in the category of paraphrasing, where you take something that somebody else has written and you basically rewrite it in your own words. Okay? But please note that this rewriting extends above and way beyond converting active to passive. Okay? This is really rewritten. And we've all done paraphrasing also in our school, when we used to be given passages and be asked to do it. So, paraphrasing is better than copying, certainly, but best is to write a summary. So now there are three things. One is quoting word by word from some source with quotation marks and with citation. The second is paraphrasing. And then the third thing that I've introduced here is summary. Okay. So what is summary? What do we do when we write a summary? Is that we take a long passage or we take a long article or we take a story or we take a novel. We identify the main ideas. This is important. Background information should be given only if you think without that background information, these main ideas cannot be appreciated. Otherwise, avoid all extra information. Focus only on the crux of the matter and then write it in your own words. That's summarizing. Okay, so what I would like you to do now, there is this passage, it's about Yosemite National Park, and write a summary. Summary, remember the key part is get the main idea of the passage and put it down. That's all that is needed in a summary. Yes, please.
I have a question regarding this plagiarism check softwares.
Yeah.
Even then, I checked my article. It's 100% original. I checked it and finally I got the result, 84% original and 16% plagiarized.
Did you include the bibliography?
I included the bibliography.
Yeah, so there is an option of excluding bibliography.
More than that, what it said, plagiarized items, it is something in quotation. Because I quoted an article from Alice Walker, Toni Morrison, Zora Neale, so many authors. Used by someone else, referred by someone else. They also refer the same content in their article.
Right. So you're taking a quote from Toni Morrison, putting it in quotation marks and say this is what Toni Morrison wrote in Sula or whatever.
Yeah.
Okay.
But for example, my colleague or else someone else from India or else anywhere, he is also quoting the same line. And it is telling that this item is plagiarized, this is present in this article, something like that.
See, so plagiarism checking softwares are reasonably good. We use one extensively now at IIT Bombay because this was getting to be a big problem and we needed to control it. So we use a software. I know for sure that it has the option of excluding bibliography when you do a similarity check. And that takes care of about 10 to 15% right there, right? Because bibliography will obviously appear as copied. So, but this quotation marks, I agree with you. I mean, so I would not take that as plagiarized content. And if a student submits a report to me, I usually ask them to submit to me the output of this plagiarism checking software. And then I go through whatever has been flagged. And if the only things that are flagged are things which are in quotation marks, I will say this is fine. I mean, you know, the software is obviously not as smart as I am. I can decide for myself that this is not plagiarized content. And I'm pretty sure that in most places where they check for plagiarized content, they don't go simply by the software numbers alone. They actually look at what has been flagged. And I think stuff in quotes should be okay.
I think this.
I am not aware of softwares which can be told to avoid think text that is in quotation marks.
I think all these tools, they exclude the content inside the quotation.
Yeah, so I don't really know that. I mean, I don't have an. They don't. Okay, so they'll flag that also. Yeah, so then I think it's for the reviewer to see and. I mean, I'm reasonably sure if the reviewer sees that it's just stuff in quotation marks, that is okay. I mean, that is how you're supposed to quote.
Madam, which tool you are using here?
We are using Turnitin. There's a software called Turnitin. I think several IIMs use that, IIC Bangalore uses that, and it works very well.
Yeah.
Turnitin, T-U-R-N.
No, I checked in Turnitin, and there it was same. In Turnitin itself, it was not.
It doesn't flag things was, that are in quotation marks. Yeah. So maybe, did you use a different software? Which one did you use?
So even I used Turnitin.
You used Turnitin. So maybe there is an option. He says that when you use Turnitin, it doesn't flag. Right. So there is an option, it seems, to ignore stuff in quotation marks. So just like bibliography is also an option. Okay.
Ma'am, when I paraphrase or when I write a summary of someone else's content, it's no longer plagiarism. If I'm not giving credit, you've written something.
No. You always have to give credit.
Okay.
You cannot not give credit. But
I can write it without using quotes. That's
yes,
the only difference.
Yes, right.
Okay. So thank you.
Word by word reproduction needs quotes.
Okay. But if I've paraphrased it,
if you've paraphrased it, you've summarized it, you just say, you know, you just put the reference, citation, and then you're okay. No quotations needed.
Okay, so I just put it as a reference. But
right.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Well, I thought Sundar told you first day that people have to be called by their names and this is my name. It's Prita.
Okay. Cultural thing, we've been discussing about it.
I see.
And we realize it's difficult, not so easy.
Yes, please.
Sometimes what happened when we look at the result we got from Turnitin or Viper software, the plagiarized text what we got is basically in different context than what we have written. Let's say example, I have written data mining, database. These are some common words maybe used in some other sources for different contexts. And I have not copied there, but somehow those words,
are matching.
And that shows similarity percentage, right? And why it matters, like sometimes in some conferences, they have some threshold. Let's say sir has told that 20% would be allowed. So if it's more than 20 or let's say it would be 21%, it straight away reject it without looking into the context why it is showing the text.
Okay.
And when we got the rejection,
okay.
And we really look at the results, the report,
right.
It shows that this was not an intention of us to copy it, but somehow those common words matches with somebody else writing in a different context. And because of that, what to do?
See, I think if it is scattered words, if it is commonly used words, as you're saying, you know, data. Now, you know, what else do you say? What other synonym do you use? Or database for that matter. Or, you know, there would be so many things. Internet, right? Flow diagram. I don't know if just these commonly used words would add up to over 20% in a paper. Maybe they do, as you're saying.
Maybe borderline, I'm not. But
if there are other sentences, so what I ask my students to do, so plagiarism, is not always intentional. You know, sometimes it is, you know, you wrote something and you may have remembered four sentences. You wrote them in a certain way because there was a book that you read 2 weeks back and it was just there, you know, in the back of your mind. You didn't open the book and you start typing and copying. So these plagiarism checking softwares are also helpful in avoiding this problem. That before I submit a paper, I do a check for myself. So we tell our students that before you submit the report, do a check. If the content is over 20%, please edit your report yourself so that the content comes to below 20% and then submit. That is to help those people who have no intention of cheating. No, we understand that this can happen. So I think you should make use of these softwares to help you with this problem as well before you upload an abstract or a manuscript or something.
One more doubt or kind of question, that does it matter that the which part of the paper has this percentage? Let's in the introduction or let's say literature survey, we have an more percent, but
no. We
are not bare with anything in experimental study or...
Nope, doesn't matter. I mean, there is also something called self-plagiarism, right? I have a student here, now he makes a setup, right? He makes a very beautiful schematic of that setup. He writes a description. We publish a paper in his third year. Now he's in his fifth year, he's using the same setup, right? He can't just go copy, after all, it's his figure, he made it. He can't just copy paste the same figure, copy that one paragraph of instrument description or experiment description from his paper, put it in and publish it. Even self-plagiarism is plagiarism. So you can't. I mean, which is why it makes no difference whether it comes in the introduction section or the literature review section or in the experimental methods section, doesn't matter. I mean, plagiarism is plagiarism.
Actually, ma'am, if the same author is writing two papers and if some contents are matching, is it considered as in plagiarism?
Right. That's what I said. Self-plagiarism is also plagiarism. I cannot claim that I made that drawing. I took that photograph. This is my data. I cannot publish it at two places.
But it should be different for the different parts of the paper, no? Because the results and discussion can be, for that, the label of percentage can be high. But if we talk about in literature review, it should be less.
No. Because see, what is expected is that one is, you're not going to solve the same problem twice, right? You're not going to publish a paper on the same thing twice. You know, high temperature behavior of concrete. You won't publish the same thing two times over. So the background, you know, if you say high temperature concrete used in tropical countries and high temperature concrete used in, I don't know, Sweden, the background is different, the literature is different, and every paper is expected to be freshly written. And you can do this experiment on yourself, that if you read an article today and you decide to write a summary of that article tomorrow, forget all about it, go back to it 2 months later. Read the same article and write a summary of the same article. It'll not be the same. Even an individual, if you write it afresh, we don't write things the same way over and over again. No, so there was a comment there,
yeah.
And
yeah.
Sorry?
Your idea remains the same, right?
Idea remains the same, but this is a representation of that idea. The same individual will also not represent the same idea in the same words every single time.
We have seen many papers from elsewhere and it's been published in conference 2010 and same is being published in journal in 2012 and with a little experimental study added to that. Author must have cited that also it was previously published in 2010 with this conference.
Okay.
Now he has she has added.
So this is an excellent point and this is very common. I mean, you know, you're working with a student, he's got some preliminary data. And you say, well, there's a good conference. Why don't you go talk about your preliminary data? Let's get the feedback from the audience. And then we are going to, you know, build up on this. So there is a preliminary data, there is a paper, you know, there is some 3-page conference proceedings that gets published. And then you do a lot more work, you do a lot more analysis and you publish another paper. Strictly speaking, even in situations like this, no two figures in your conference paper and your journal paper should be the same. The fact that I have seen people who do it, yes, I've also seen people who do it, okay, doesn't make it right. The fact that it happens and it gets accepted doesn't mean that in this forum where we are trying to understand that what we should be doing if we want to be correct. Okay, there this distinction still remains that whether you publish it in a conference proceeding or you publish it in a journal paper, yes, it is your own work. Yes, it is the same core idea. You do not reproduce the same data, the same figure, the same schematic. You do not copy paste the same paragraph from one paper to another, even your own paper.
But ma'am, in many journals we found that such kind of papers are publishing.
This argument is like my students' argument that people do it and people get away with it. They don't get caught in the peer reviewing process. Sure.
That part only. I'm going to share something.
So I actually had, I'll give you my experience. One of my students tried to do exactly this, that he went for a conference and he had some very preliminary results. And then he wrote a journal paper at the end of his M.Tech. And the only thing that was similar was the schematic. This is what my setup looks like. Okay? And the reviewer slammed him really hard for it. The reviewer said, this is copied from this. This paper should be rejected. Didn't matter that he had worked really hard after that. Didn't matter that the results were new. Didn't matter that the analysis was really, really robust. Okay? So, yes, it is done. Yes, you can also go ahead and do it. But yes, this also happens, that my student's really good work got thrown out of the window without a review because the reviewer said this figure is the same and we were guilty as charged.
Ma'am, in that case, there isn't.
Peer review process is not uniform. I mean, it's subjective, right? It's like saying, you know, I think this color is violet or, you know, pink or purple. Peer review process is like that. It's a matter of opinion. It's you know, yes, it's unfair. Yes, it's not uniform. That's just how it is.
So no? Level of the
I agree, but the reviewer has no means of evaluating your intent. So that is the problem, right? No, you're not cheating yourself. That's okay.
You are not cheating.
The question is that
the review
is quite different, journal to journal.
No. So, okay. Let me put it like this, that you will still sleep well at night. The paper may get rejected.
No,
that's
simultaneously
okay.
What
so,
happened?
You know, what's the main idea of this paragraph?
Preserving nature.
Is it only about, because there is sort of a sadness in this paragraph, right? So what is the sadness about?
About not being able to experience nature the way it should be.
Okay.
About putting those man-made boundaries and allowing you to take only pictures and you know, leaving footprints, and you don't experience nature as nature should be.
Right. So that's the central idea, right? That it's a beautiful place, but it's not a place, or the way, you know, things are being run in Yosemite National Park, you don't experience nature, you know, you don't become one with nature. You go, you see, take pictures, beautiful sunrise, beautiful sunset, and you come back. So that's sort of the sadness or the wistfulness, or that's sort of the main theme of this thing. And I think, so Sandhya there has captured it very well. There is another person here. Your name is?
Rajesh.
So, you know, three or four sentences does it once you grab the idea. So, when we are summarizing something, that's what we need to do. We need to spend time sort of figuring out what's the essence of what's being said and then just say it in our own words. Okay? Yeah, so there is, you know, there is, this was the summary that was given. So I've taken this content from the website here. There are actually lots and lots of sources. So I've taken this content from here, and what they say, have traditionally as a work of art marked by distinct borders. And this person, while they acknowledge that this does protect the park, but it limits the individual's relation. So similar thing, right? But that's the right. So what does a summary do? It condenses, it captures only the main points, and then these points are expressed in the writer's language, you know. So my language if I'm writing, your language if you are writing. So those are the important things. Now paraphrasing is slightly different, because paraphrasing is not, you know, getting the essence and then just representing the essence. Paraphrasing is more like, take this text and now present it in your own words, you know, not necessarily just the main idea of the text, okay, or just the thought behind what is being written here. It captures the entire passage, but importantly re-expresses it in new language, rewrites it in your own language, in language which is different from the original text, okay. So this becomes the important part. So now, if you had to write a paraphrase of this paragraph, right, you've already captured the essence, you've done it in very few sentences, you've done it in very few words, but now we're not doing that. We are going to rewrite this entire paragraph, but in our own languages, okay. Then what would you do? 5 minutes, okay. Can you attempt writing a paraphrase of this thing? And if you think 5 minutes is too short for this, since you're going to paraphrase the entire text, you know, take the first 4 sentences and paraphrase those. Just try it out. And please remember, paraphrasing doesn't mean that we have to do it sentence by sentence. Right? So when I say take the first 4 sentences, you can change the order as long as you can, you know, present what's in the first 4 sentences in a coherent form. That's all. Does anybody want to read out what they've already written? So this is now the paraphrase, right?
There are undue regulations which restrict the way a visitor would experience Yosemite National Park. That's all.
So that's a paraphrase or a summary?
Just the first 4 sentences.
Okay. So, does this fall in the category of paraphrasing or does this fall in the category of summarizing? Right. So, this is summarizing, right? Where we said that let's capture the essence of what's being said and write it ourselves. Paraphrasing is that we sort of, we are rewriting that text in our own words. So when we were going for coffee, somebody said that, well, you know, they have a colleague who works with some radars, and then the specifications of those radars have to be written and how can they be different and so on. So I mean, paraphrasing in a way is that kind of an exercise, right? That you say the same things that are there, but say it differently. So that's the big difference between summarizing and paraphrasing. So this is an example of a paraphrase. Solnit is the author, sorry. So, you know, in the previous one also, where is the question? Yes.
I'm done with it.
Sorry?
I'm done with it.
Oh, excellent. Please read it.
There are many a heritage around the world, of which Yosemite is one. Its importance is apparent with the gift of frame put around. But this site is not now facing a serious danger of intrusion. Man has since the beginning tried to intrude into many parts forcefully and ruthlessly, destroying the basic essence of sanctity and privacy of the place.
Okay. So what has happened in your summary is that or this is a paraphrase of this, or is this a summary? It's a paraphrase, right? But the original text doesn't say anything about forceful entry of man from, you know, a long time or something. So please understand that in paraphrasing, we are really not altering or condensing the content, okay? What we are doing is simply saying what the author has originally said. But because I don't want to use quotation marks and copy an entire paragraph, I'm going to say this same thing my way. But the important thing is say the same thing.
say unthoughtfully?
Well, unthoughtfully, but I mean, unthoughtful or forceful, where is that idea anywhere in this paragraph?
I know, but something which has been restricted and the person should not be doing it, so...
No, what the author is actually trying to say is that because that the fact that the entry of people has been very tightly regulated into this park is depriving those visitors from experiencing nature as they should. It's only permitting you to sort of view things as an outsider. Okay, so if I had to argue, I would say the author's sympathies are actually with the visitors. No, so he doesn't seem to imply that some gross danger or damage is being done to the park. Okay, so that, yes, please.
Being preserved as a painting, Yosemite is a very clean park. To let all the people enjoy original beauty of nature, there are strict rules to be followed. After all, to live in the paradise of nature, we must respect such kind of park by following such kind of rules.
Okay, I would say partly okay, but again, the author says nothing about rules, right? Or do they? Indirectly they do. So if I said, well, you know, let's distill the essence of it, then, you know, maybe. But this is what I'm trying to point out, that when we say paraphrase, right, we are saying that take this text and rewrite this text. We're not saying that, no, what was the thought behind the text? What was the intent of the text? We are literally, you know, rewording it, if that makes it clearer. Okay. One more and then we're going to move on.
Yeah, can I try?
Yeah, please.
It is difficult to comprehend the beauty of nature through the lens of camera, but we are compelled to do so as a result of different conservation activities, which makes it less lively masterpieces, as is the case with Yosemite.
Pretty good. Now, is this a summary or a paraphrase in your opinion?
Actually, I have tried to paraphrase it.
You've tried to paraphrase it. Okay. So, I mean, if again, you know, I may not be the expert, but I think this is an excellent summary. This is an okay paraphrase.
Actually, I started with the...
You started with the summary and you ended up with a paraphrase. Okay. Here.
Yosemite has been preserved like a painting. The boundaries of the park are like the photo frame of a painting. Pictures of the park can be taken just as we can leave footprints. The reason for the above is simple, since the park has to be protected. A tourist is like an outsider who can only appreciate the park as a painting without experiencing nature.
Very good. Probably the best paraphrase that we've heard so far. So.
The experience of a tourist at Yosemite Park leaves one asking for more. Though the tourist goes there to admire the beauty of nature, to be able to spend some time with it, all he is allowed to do is to go around and take pictures. The over-preservation of Yosemite is to be blamed for it. This policy leaves a tourist out of the whole experience like a stranger out of the gates of heaven.
Very good. I only would take, if I had to sort of nitpick, I would say that the author, though he says that it has been preserved as though it were a painting and these are like gilt frames, he doesn't call it over preservation, right? That's a value judgment that we are putting, which the author doesn't seem to have put. And the other thing is that in the paraphrasing, that one part got missed. If we say everything has to be sort of rewritten in our own words, then the part that, you know, the boundaries are like this, blah, 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 the frame part. So, but other than that, very, very good summary. Thank you. So, thanks to all of you who read your writings. I really do appreciate it. And, you know, otherwise I cannot teach this topic as a monologue. It just doesn't work for me. So, I'm very, very thankful to you. So this is, again, you know, this is what was in the website, that this is the paraphrase. So as a work of art, the park is represented as nature, appropriately experienced as one might experience a painting only through sight. And this makes sense in light of throngs of people, blah, blah. It limits the ways in which an individual might experience the park's landscape. Since it implies that there are two that's here, that's an error. Nature is to be viewed and not altered, that it is to be visited and not lived in. So again, you know, nearly all of you, the good paraphrases have captured all of these. Now there is another example, okay. Now that you've spent so much time looking at that original passage, I think you remember large parts of that passage. So here is another piece of writing or rewriting of the same passage or representation of the same passage. Please read this. And tell me, what do you think this is? The writer has given some comments about that passage. Okay? Let me show you something in this. So, if I ran it through Turnitin or through Viper, all of this has been just taken from the original passage and we've rearranged words around it so that it looks different. But if I could put in front of you both the passages at the same time, you will find that there is a lot of commonality. Okay? So what I have found helps is that if I read a paper and having the paper on my desk, I try to write about that paper, I will often, even unconsciously, end up doing this, having just read the paper, because it's so fresh in my memory. What helps is that while writing the papers, if I make copious notes, and then when I have to write about those papers, I don't go back to the papers at all. I just sit with my notes and I write about it. And then I can go back and fact check, you know, were they really doing that test at 10 tor or was it actually 15 tor? Okay, was the temperature really 573 or was the temperature 285? Those can be checked. But this often happens if we read and immediately try to write about something. Or if, you know, I have three papers open and I'm saying, okay, you know, this looks good, that explanation is nice, and, you know, like some of you were saying, I am not trying to copy. My intent is never to copy. But I've just read it. It's just so fresh in my memory. There is a way of saying that thing that is already in front of me, and it happens. So, now let's come back to this quotation business, okay, when do you quote? And I'll show you an example of that, that quotations, firstly, should be used as sparingly as possible, because as, sorry, what's your name?
Ashwin Kumar Mishra.
Okay, so as Mr. Mishra was pointing out, or Professor Mishra was pointing out, that if you keep quoting text, right, then it's like, well, you didn't even bother writing. You didn't even bother putting it into your own words, you know. Not only is the idea from someplace else, even the words are from someplace else, okay. So, excessive use of quotations should be strongly avoided. Places where you may still want to use quotations are, you know, if you are in the field of linguistics and you actually want to discuss the language of something. You know, Shakespeare wrote something in somewhere and you want to discuss his use of a certain phrase or a certain word, then obviously you have to quote that sonnet from Shakespeare, right? Or you are discussing an author's position or theory and you want to discuss the wording of some core idea of the author. You know, there is some very fundamental idea and you want to present it as such, because then you are going to dissect that idea very thoroughly. Then maybe you don't want to rewrite it. You want to present as the author presented it and then present your analysis of it. Or if you think that the way that whatever the author has written, you will miss the essence of that when you try to do a translation. You've tried doing a translation and you felt that whatever you write just doesn't convey exactly the sentiment or the atmosphere or the meaning that the author meant, okay? Or when you want to appeal to the authority of the author and using his or her words will emphasize that authority. You know, like what I showed you from Samuel Johnson, Now, I wanted to show you those words. And my paraphrasing or my rewriting would have diluted that impact. Okay. So, here is an example that on the morning after Ted, this is the original passage. On the morning after Ted Lavender died, First Lieutenant Jimmy Cross crouched at the bottom of his foxhole and burned Martha's letters. Then he burned the two photographs. There was a steady rain falling, which made it difficult, but he used heat tabs and sterno to build a small fire, screening it with his body, holding the photographs over the tight blue flame with the tip of his fingers. He realized it was only a gesture, stupid he thought, sentimental too, but mostly just stupid. Now, you know, if you were sort of writing a paper where you were discussing this text that was written, then you may want to sort of cite this. Even as Jimmy Cross burns Martha's letters, he realizes that it was only a gesture. Stupid, he thought. Sentimental too, but mostly just stupid. Okay? Because there is, you know, there is such poignancy in those words that here is somebody who's probably, you know, it's probably World War I or something, which is why they are in foxholes. We stopped fighting in foxholes and resorted to bombing each other from long distance after that. But, you know, here is somebody and somebody's friend has died, and I don't know the rest of this text, so I don't know why those letters and those photographs have to be burned. But here is somebody doing something, at the same time sort of analyzing their actions. And, you know, sort of thinking that, well, I'm being a sentimental fool in what I'm doing. But it is still important enough to do it. So, there are times when you may decide that quotation carries an impact, conveys a sentiment, conveys an atmosphere, carries a weight, you know, states a concept in a way that absolutely nothing else can do. Only under those circumstances should we resort to using quotations. Otherwise, don't, you know, just write it. Write it the way you would like to write it. Now, I have an exercise for you. This is easier because you don't have to write anything, you just have to identify. So, this is the primary text. Students frequently overuse direct quotation in taking notes, and as a result, they overuse quotations in the final paper. Exactly the kind of thing we don't want them to do. Probably only 10% of your final manuscript should appear as directly quoted matter. Therefore, strive to limit the amount of exact transcribing of source materials while taking notes. Okay. Now, this original text has been written three times, three different ways. Please read these three and classify them as summary, paraphrasing, and one is plagiarized. Okay, so please read and just, you know, do a one is this and two is this and three is this. So write it down and then we'll ask people to for their answers. Done?
Yes.
So now what I'm going to do is you are going to evaluate your own this thing. I'll show you the answers, and these are the answers. And I want you to tell me how many people got all three correct. Self-evaluation. Okay. How many people got two things correct? Okay. And only one correct? One correct is a little difficult, right? Because you're assigning three labels to three things. So, if you... Okay. So, those who got two correct, two things correct, can somebody please tell me where the mismatch was between what's here and what you had? Those who got any two of the things correct, can you please tell me where was the mismatch between your answer and what's been put up? Anybody? No, something which you thought was a summary was a paraphrase, something which you thought was plagiarized text turned out to be the summary. Yes, please.
Second statement at the time, right. I have not seen that third statement. So, there was the confuse when it
I
asked
see.
About.
Okay.
So first one is the plagiarism is fine.
That was clear.
Second one, when second and third, I have to take the compare. But before that, I have to check that second one.
Okay.
Then third one has come. So at that time, I committed that.
I see.
So
this
is the difference. If I'm going
paraphrasing
to
paraphrasing and summarizing. So you think that if you saw the two together, it will be very easy for you to tell that this is a summary and this is a paraphrase. Is that correct? So if you see the two things together,
What have I done? Exactly, I have made that sum of the paraphrase.
Mm-hmm.
So I felt that it is linked to my concept. So far I put it.
Okay.
But when I have seen that third statement,
right,
I have not think about that summarizations.
I see.
That's
okay.
The problem.
Okay. Anybody else? Are there other, I mean, the reason I'm asking you for where there was a mismatch is because that suggests that there is something that we should still clarify. Okay. So if you can point that out, then we can clarify that now. Now I have a couple of points, comments. These slides are going to be uploaded. Okay. So when I upload the slides, I'm going to actually put additional passages because there's only so much writing that one can do here. So I'm going to put a few more passages with exercises for summarizing and paraphrasing and so on. Now, since you will be going back and you will be helping us conduct this workshop and you'll be participating in this workshop, exercises usually work best if the instructor is fairly familiar with the exercise. So my request is that please do go through those passages before you participate in teaching this to more students. Okay, so there'll be some 2-3 more passages there, and when I put those passages, I will also be able to put evaluation guidelines. Right now those are not there. Okay,
we have two different terms in English. Basically, one is pressy and there is another condensation. So basically, what's the difference among condensation, summary and pressy?
What's the difference between condensation, summary and pressy? So I am actually not familiar with condensation. I mean, I'm trying to recall this from when I took language courses. So we used to have a pressy, and the pressy that we used to write was like the paraphrase here, that take an entire text and present the whole text in your own words. I don't know what condensation is. Really, I have no idea.
Pressy is also that is one-third verse of the original.
I see. So there is a word limit there.
One-third.
Okay.
One-third.
Okay. So then pressy seems closer to summary than paraphrase. See, again, I think the way you need to convey to your students or to your colleagues, whoever will be participating in the next workshop, is that the reason we are emphasizing upon these things is that because we want to use these as writing tools, right? That when I say that I'm presenting literature on aerospace alloys, then probably reading papers and taking the central idea of those papers and writing a summary is what is the best course of action. Okay, paraphrasing is probably not something that we would want to do a lot of when we are doing a literature presentation. Right? You've read 100 papers and you're going to summarize that in 6 pages in your report. So writing a summary is most useful at that point in time. Get the central idea. Okay, say that, whatever. Zhu and et al. Tested these alloys from a temperature range of 400 to 1000 and they found that the best candidate was. And they found that this material was good as far as impact toughness was concerned and this material was very good as far as high temperature corrosion was concerned. Whatever, right? That's the idea that you have to use in a literature review. A paraphrase probably comes in more handy when you have something which is, probably more in a social sciences kind of a setting where you've got an idea that has been described and you don't want to tamper a whole lot with the idea that has been described, but you don't want to copy that text either. Okay. And for students, the students who are starting out, summarizing may not be very easy, right? For them to read a 6-page research paper and come up with a 5-line summary is a huge challenge. So you can start them out by saying, okay, paraphrase it. Paraphrase their introduction, paraphrase their main results, and paraphrase their conclusions. Once they've had practice doing this and they've done this for about 40 papers, then maybe they can get to the idea that, you know what, I don't have to paraphrase this and paraphrase this and paraphrase this. I can really extract the main idea out of a paper. But that comes with practice. And if you take a fresh M.Tech student and say, here is a review paper. Come back to me with a half-page summary of this. The student will never come back. Okay? But if you say, no, you know, here is a 20-page review paper. Paraphrase it in about 10 pages. That's okay, the student can manage that, at least make a very good attempt at doing that. And after they've been doing this for some time, then you say, look, now that you understand, now that you can talk about other people's work in your own words, now let's try the next step. Now let's try talking about this in one paragraph. Okay? So I think that is how these should be presented. That, you know, it's
conceptual minimization.
Conceptual minimization is summary. You know, so I like the phrase distilling the essence. That is summary. You know, that's what you have to do. Any other questions, comments, concerns? Okay.